there's this symbolic importance to it. And of course, once you start, when you have a system of thought and then discrete facts within that system, once you start investigating each of these discrete facts and start throwing them out, well, that's not true, that's not true, that's not true, that's not true. You then have to step back and you have to say, is the framework itself true at all? Or, I mean, it's true to some extent, because we do live in this technological society, one that I admittedly believe is collapsing. So it has to, there has to be some part that's true, but which part? And is it a fundamentally constructed false narrative in order to justify a certain agenda? And that's a conclusion that I find harder and harder to resist. So now we get to, you know, the unthinkable, right? The idea that nuclear weapons aren't real. Again, not saying that's the only explanation, but then, you know, why would we give them the benefit of the doubt so far? They've lied to us consistently all the time since, you know, as soon as this system was set up. And, you know, let's just somewhat arbitrarily say it was 1913 with the Federal Reserve Bank. Okay, well, you know, from then on, they just keep lying to us. So that's another problem. Somebody might say, well, you know, the science works out, the math works out. Well, okay, I mean, you know, the math works out for AI. I never see it. We never get to HAL 9000. You know, the math works out for a whole bunch of other things that we just don't see. It's part of a scientific millenarianism. Oh, one day we'll get to AI, and that will solve all of our problems. And that was part of what the Soviets were trying to do in the 80s to solve the problem of scientific planning of production. No, we just have computers, cybernetics, that'll solve it. It's a kind of, you know, utopianism. It's not going to happen. And so I'm thinking, well, maybe that's like with this, right? And how much do we want to, you know, actually throw out? How much do we want to do? And I mean, depending on what stage of progression you're at, leaving what, you know, these received narratives, you know, you're going to find one or other of these five more or less plausible. The other thing then is, if they are fake, then what was the point? Well, with Baudrillard and simulations, right, we have four orders of simulation. The first order simulation is an attempt at a relatively faithful reproduction of the real thing. A second order simulation is trying to hide what is present. The third order simulation is trying to hide what is not present. And then the fourth order simulation is hyper-reality and makes no reference to anything but itself. It you know, it's not trying to hide anything per se. It's trying to assert its own existential reality onto you. And the way this narrative has been used, mutually assured destruction, atomic weapons, it seems to be hiding something. It seems to be a part of this simulated reality that we're living in. So then the question is, well, what's trying to be hidden? What is the purpose? I mean, partly the rollout of this global interconnected system begins in, of course, 1945, the end of the Second World War. And it needs to be painted as inevitable. It needs to be painted as, this is just what's going to happen, folks. Just get on board with it. And yeah, one way that you can do that is, you know, you use this act of destruction to do this, to say, hey, look, you know, this is the power of our theology, our metaphysic. We just leveled the whole city with one bomb. And then, like, well, okay, better not stand up to that guy. We're just gonna get wasted. And so what this sort of is serving as is it's like a magic trick, right? Look, what a magician does is they want you to look at the hand that's doing some sort of like over the top visual, but the actual trick is taking place with the other hand that you're not watching. So this could be the over the top visual. So what are they trying to do? Well, what they're trying to do is build a technological dictatorship, which was written about by Aldous Huxley in Brave New World. It was written about by Bertrand Russell in The Scientific Outlook and the Impact of Science on Society, and it was written about by H.G. Wells in The New World Order and The Open Conspiracy. So, and there were two ways that they could hide what they were doing. Threats, so unlimited destruction, And then also the promises of utopian scientific achievements, which we never actually get to. So let's sort of go back and just sort of re-summarize everything. The fact is nobody acts like nuclear weapons are real. There's people are telling us that there's going to be a third world war in Europe and the East East Asia, possibly also the Middle East. This just shouldn't be happening, right? Right? It's given what we have all heard about mutually assured destruction and the thresholds that at which nuclear war would be triggered, we've already passed the threshold because large-scale conventional military conflict was supposed to be impossible. So the fact that it's already happening means we've already crossed the threshold that MAD tells us nukes would be used. So I'm not making this assumption on the claim that, oh, well, we're getting close to a tipping point. No, we've already passed it. We're like way, way past it. And nothing's happened. And that just, again, it's like one of the biggest script flips ever. And no one's talking about this. There's a few people talking about it. I mean, I recently heard today that academic agent has talked about this, the idea that they act like nukes aren't real. It's you know, how do we explain this? And so the potential five explanations are that nukes aren't real and they never were. ABMs are really good, rendering ICBMs obsolete. Collapse means that they're just too energy expensive. You know, you can't even use them after all, so just get rid of them. Mutually assured destruction, everybody's just agreed, is not really feasible anymore because, you know, it's not a proportionate response, or they're insane and they're going to lead us into, you know, Dr. Strangelove land. So those are the five options on the table. Depending on how much of the narrative you think is still worth believing in is going to depend on how you think about this. The main thing that needs explaining is the Cold War, because then why didn't this military conflict develop sooner? Well, we can draw inspiration from Francis Parker Yockey's America's Two Ways of Waging War and 1984, that this was a giant frozen conflict. So in terms of geopolitics, a frozen conflict is a conflict in which there is no active direct hostilities. Nobody's shooting guns at each other, but they're not, there's no peace treaty, there's no armistice. Well, there might be an armistice, but there's no peace treaty and they're not at a state of peace. Now, why would you want to maintain that for 40 years? Well, control is a good one to do it. 1984 tells us. And then also the Soviets were broadly aligned to the metaphysic of our age, of technique, as Ernst Jünger would talk about. And that Russia and China today have more in common with Germany and Japan of World War II in that they reject this system and are approaching third positionist policies.